give him praise in his house today. He's worthy of praise, isn't he? Just for a few minutes, we're going to go ahead and call the ushers, and we're going to start our worship as we give. Let me just make one quick announcement. Some of you have already donated to Robbie Beavers, and we certainly appreciate that. We're not going to take up an official collection for him, but if you want to donate something to Robbie for all the medical bills and everything, you can just give it to me after service, and I'll make sure that the family gets that. So thank you guys. It's already good to have our guests with us in service today and all those who are here. So I'm going to ask the ushers to come. We're going to worship through giving. How many knows that giving is part of worship? Absolutely. When they used to come to that synagogue, they had to bring something with them. And even though it went into the New Testament temple, the Apostle Paul said a cheerful giver. It's what the Lord likes, and I appreciate you guys for your giving. All right. Father, we thank you today. We thank you that we're able to be here in your house together. Thank you for these who have joined us by way of the internet. So now, Lord, as we begin our worship here, as we have glorified you and praised you just coming into the doors, Holy Spirit, we want you just to have your way among us and know that we're here to worship you and praise you and glorify you, Father. So just have your way today as we lift your name in your sanctuary. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship. Amen. Let's worship.
Troubles and cares of the story that wanted Thank you. music.
My goodness, I'm telling you. Looking forward to that day when I can bow on my knees and cry glory.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes. I'm still worshiping, so
that's all right. Thank you.
Amen. When I thank him for dying for a sinner like me.
Yeah.
When it comes right down to it, that's what it's all about right there. That's what it's all about right there. We're going to talk about making choices today. How many of you have ever had to make a choice? I'm sure. I'm going to ask you to turn to the book of Joshua. Good old Joshua. Man, chapter 24. I'm sure you Bible readers have been through this. You probably read it a lot. I want to talk about the choices that we have to make in regards to staying true to God. I mean, it may not seem like it's an everyday choice, but it certainly is. It certainly is. We all have to make decisions. We all have choices that we have to make.
Amen.
So in Joshua chapter 24, I'm going to read verses, start at 1 and go all the way down through 15, so that we can understand where Joshua is when he gives this address to the people there in Israel. Joshua chapter 24. Then Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem, and he called for the elders of Israel, for their heads, the head of the tribes, and for their judges, and for their officers. And they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord God. Thus says the Lord God of Israel. Your fathers, including Terah, the father of Abraham, and the father of Nahor, they dwelt on the other side of the river, and in old times, and they served other gods. Then, God says, I took your father Abraham from the other side of the river, led him throughout all the land of Canaan, and multiplied his descendants, and gave him Isaac. And to Isaac I gave Jacob and Esau. To Esau I gave the mountains of Seir to possess. But Jacob and his children went down to Egypt. Also I sent Moses and Aaron, and I plagued Egypt according to what I did among them. Afterward, I brought you out, and then I brought your fathers out of Egypt, and you came to the sea, and the Egyptians pursued your fathers with chariots and horsemen to the Red Sea. So they cried out to the Lord, your fathers did, and he put darkness between you and the Egyptians, and he brought the sea upon them and covered them. And your eyes saw what I did in Egypt. And then you dwelt in the wilderness a long time, and I brought you into the land of the Amorites, who dwelt on the other side of the Jordan. And they fought with you, but I gave them into your hand, that you might possess their land, and I destroyed them from before you. Then Balak, the son of Zippor, the king of Moab, he arose to make war against Israel and sent and called Balaam, the son of Beor, to curse you. But I would not listen to Balaam. Therefore, he continued to bless you. So I delivered you out of his hand. And then you went over the Jordan, and you came to Jericho. And the men of Jericho fought against you. Also the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Girgashites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. But I delivered them into your hand, and I sent the hornet before you, which drove them out from before you. Now that word hornet means fear in that particular verse, not an actual bee. I sent fear before you, which drove them out. Also, the two kings of the Amorites, but not with your sword or with your bow. I have given you a land for which you did not labor, and cities which you did not build, and you dwell in them. You eat of the vineyards and olive groves which you did not plant. Now, therefore, in other words, knowing all that, now, therefore, hear the Lord. Serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the river and in Egypt. Serve the Lord! Exclamation point. And if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your fathers, the ones that they served, were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you now dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Amen.
Boy, I hope that's a choice you make today. I hope that you're choosing. Father, we thank you that we've had this time of worship together. And now, Lord, comes the time we worship in this word. So as you have guarded it down through the centuries, and you have brought it unto us here at Draper Valley today, I pray, Father, that just as you inspired the writer who put the words down then, that you inspire our hearts, that we might see that which you have for us today as a church and as individuals, that we might draw closer to you as disciples, and that we might be better evangelists to this lost world we're in today. And we'll thank you for it, and we'll give you the glory and the praise that you will bow our knee to you. In your name, Jesus, we say it by faith, and all his people would say, we love you, Lord. Amen. Joshua covers about 25 years of Israel's history in his book. He wrote parts of the book, but some of it was written for him as the recording of his death and things that happened after, and we find that in the book of Judges. But Joshua was a military leader, and he was Moses' right-hand man. That's the way I would say it. He was the assistant to Moses, and God had big plans for Joshua. And when they brought the people after Moses had died to the edge of Cana, the Jordan River that separated them, then that's when the Lord met with Joshua and he gave them these words that he was to give to the rest of the people. Because he knew that Joshua was not going to be with them forever, and he knew that they needed that encouragement, and they needed those warnings, and they needed that, I guess you would say, exhalation, or however how you might pronounce that, exalting, to get them to understand that it was going to be a hard choice living in this new land. Even though God had gave it all to them, he said, you're going to have to make decisions that God has already made in a lot of cases for you, but now you're going to have to make some decisions on your own. Now, the religion of Cana. Cana was divided into several city-states. We just named them all. The Amorites and the Hivites and the Gershites and the Jebusites. The land of Cana was broken down into states or provinces or cities. And they all feuded among themselves. None of them could get along with each other. So the land was ripe for overtaking, for God to do what he had said he was going to do. It had already been prepared. And he said, I had sent the fear of you among the Israelites. I had sent the fear of you among those nations or among those cities that went ahead of you. Like a hornet would run people out of town, then the fear of you would cause them to flee. God did all that for them. The religion of Cana that they had gone into was a religion of where they worshiped serpents. Now, I wonder why they would have done that. Why would they have worshiped a serpent? You reckon it had anything to do with the fact that Moses raised one up on a staff and told them See, we read these things in Scripture, and we think, well, where could all that come about? It's like everything else that happens, especially to us as humans. We'll take one thing and make it into something else. And it was never the intent to worship that servant. The intent was to look at the sin that was killing you and repent of that sin and let God heal you. But somehow, the people in Cana, over a period of years, they were worshiping the serpents. The serpent had become a symbol of worship to them. And not only that, but they still made their children pass through the fire. They still sacrificed their kids as a sacrifice to God. That was the land that the Israelites were now going to have to overtake. And God had told Joshua, fear not, don't be afraid, because I will be with you everywhere you go. So now, at the end of his life, towards the end of his life, he called all the leaders together, and he brought them together, and he gave them this speech. He gave them this encouragement, and he told them, this is what you need to do. First of all, understand that you are where you are, not by your own doing, but it is the doing of God that has brought you to the point you're at. How many of us can say that today?
Yep.
How many of us are where we are today, not by anything we've done, although we may claim it, but it's because God has brought us to where we are.
Amen.
So, without saying, we have made some good choices for God to be able to bring us to where we are, or to get us to where we are today. And he has done that. The choosing started in the Garden of Eden. That's the first place we see that the human race had a choice. It was in the garden. One might question and say, why would God ever do that? Because he's the sovereign God. God could have just made it so there wouldn't have been a choice. Do you realize the only thing Adam and Eve knew was what God told them? He created them. He created their minds. He created their intellect. Any knowledge that they had came from him. They didn't gain any on their own. And the knowledge that he gave them was the knowledge they needed, the only knowledge they needed. But there was also other knowledge that they didn't need. And the choice came between him being all they need or this other knowledge, which was there as well, which they didn't need to know, was still there for their choosing. And we could say, well, why would God so do that? Why would he even put that tree in that garden? Why would he even do that? Because here's the way God works, even though he's sovereign. You and I were created for worship. But that worship is not robotic worship. In other words, we don't have a choice as to whether to worship him or not. We make that choice as to whether or not we're going to worship him and follow him and listen to him. And that's the way he wants it to be. He wanted us to love him and to worship him and to follow him out of our own ability. C.S. Lewis, that great atheist who became a Christian writer, who read the Bible so that he could disprove it only to find Christ and be saved by reading it. He actually put in there, does the atheist realize that the one he doesn't believe in is the one who gave him the ability to believe in the first place? So do you believe that the one we argue with is the one who gave us the ability to argue in the first place? And I don't think that people understand that. Freedom, listen, the freedom to choose can be a good thing or a bad thing. If you choose rightly, then it's a good thing that you chose. But if you choose poorly, it was a bad thing that you chose. But the choice is given to every one of us. It's not something that we just have to do. It is a choosing on our part. The world that you and I are living in today are looking for choices. Society is searching for something different than what God offers. They're looking for an alternative to Christ for eternal life. They're looking to medicine. They're looking to technology. They're looking to everything that they can find that will bring eternal life, but they don't want to get eternal life from the one who owns it and the one who created it. So there are choices being made every day as to whom they're going to follow. And if they can't find in this scripture the way they want it to be, then they will try to have another choice that they can go a different direction. Ever wondered why we got thousands and thousands of religions around the globe? It started with Abraham and Nahor. Until God pulled them out, they worshiped anything and everything. They didn't know what to worship. Somehow they had been lost since the Garden of Eden. Abel knew who to worship. Abel knew how to worship. God accepted his sacrifice. If Abel knew what to do, Cain knew what to do. Amen. It wasn't God kept a secret, but somewhere down the line, they had began to worship everything else and little g gods. By the way, there are no other gods.
Amen.
There are no other gods. It's just conceived in people's minds. When the philosopher says, did man create God in his mind, or did God create man? God created us, but for those who don't want to own up to that, then they create their own gods in their own minds, and they feel justified by doing that. They want another choice. Many Christians today struggle with choices. Many Christians today struggle with choices. And other options are being created so that they can choose the one that best suits them. Now the internet is good in one sense. It can be bad in another sense. Now, if it's on the internet, it's got to be true. Well, I'm glad you know that by now. It's going to get tougher. It's going to get tougher in discerning the truth. Jesus said if it were very possible in the last days, even the elect, even the very elect could be deceived. If it were possible. It won't be possible to deceive a born-again Christian because the Holy Spirit lives in that heart. And he's not going to let you be deceived. But if he only lives in your mind, then you might be deceived. So it's now you have to choose, as Joshua was telling them. Then I read a joke where this guy was in a Baptist church growing up, and his dad and his family, they were going to this one Baptist church on one end of the street, and there was another Baptist church on the other end of the street. And when they would come together and they would talk, one of them believed in the premillennial rapture. One of the Baptist churches believed that we would be going out before the tribulation come. The other church believed that it would be mid-tribulation when we would go. That's a big theological argument. So he said when they preached, the church they were in said that they were going to go in mid-tribulation. The next Sunday, his dad said, we're going to the other church. And he said, why? Don't you agree with this? He said, I want to be in the church that's going out before it comes. Think about that. So if one church thinks it, you'll get it later when you think about the rapture. But it's a simple thing that the choices that have been made today is the choices that people want to make on their own. There are no other choices in regards to eternal life. When Joshua told them, choose this day whom you're going to serve, there weren't two options. There was no other gods that they could serve. He was telling them, you choose your destiny. It's your destiny that you're choosing for. You choose this day. So that's what we say to the society today. You choose who you believe. You can believe the naysayers. You can believe the philosophers. You can believe whoever you want to. But you better believe this book right here. This is what you better believe, because your eternal destiny is going to depend on what it says. They were told it was their destiny they were choosing for. There are no other choices. Jesus is the only way. The only choice that people have today is either to accept that fact or reject that fact. There is no middle ground. For those who would say, well, it doesn't make any difference. Oh, yes, it very well does make a difference. You may think it doesn't make any difference, but the day is going to come that you'll realize it really did make a difference in who you believe. I told the funeral congregation just the other day, if I do not believe what this book says about life after death, I would have never been preaching that funeral. I would have laid this book down and walked away from it and be out on the river fishing. That's about how it would be. But I know that this book is right. And I know that this book teaches the truth. And that's why I read it, and that's why I preach it. Because I know in my heart that what it says is true. And that's a choice that I have made. But because I made that choice, this same God that put this word down, He is the one that confirms it in my heart. Let me tell you about God. God is not a God of doubt. He is not a God of doubt. I find that as soon as doubt finds its way in somehow into our faith and into our belief, once it comes in, you think that God would show up and just set you on fire so that you would know that what you're believing is a lie. But you know what I've learned about Him? He's going to let you go the direction you want to go. When I read the parable of the prodigal son, and I read that that father gave that boy everything he asked for, and then the father says, my son, which was dead, is now alive. The old man thought he would never see him again. Think about that. He gave him everything he wanted, knowing that he may never see him again. God has given us everything that we need, knowing that we may not follow Him. Think about that.
We have choices or consequences.
Thank you, Jack. You read my note. Right there is what it said. Thank you, Lord. That's a confirmation. I wrote down the right thing. Absolutely. It is the consequences. It is the consequences. And not to decide. Listen, not to decide is a decision. Right? Well, I'm just not going to. I'm not going to think about that right now. You know, the Greeks told Paul when he was in Athens, and they invited him to speak so that they might learn some new thing from him. And when Paul spoke to them, and he began to tell them, now he didn't name Jesus specifically, but they knew who he was talking about when he said, and raised him from the dead, he lost them. He lost them. And they said, well, we'll hear you again on this matter. If they ever call Paul back to preach, it's not recorded. They said, we'll hear you again on this matter. I hope that they did, because their salvation depended on it. So I hope that at some point they heard Paul again and they realized that what he was preaching was the truth. Jesus told a bunch of Pharisees when they came together and they accused him of casting out a demon by the hand of demons. Jesus had told them, you are of your father, the devil. Can you imagine that? You are of your father, the devil. So that tells me there's no in between. You either serve the Lord or you're serving Satan.
Amen.
Well, I'm not serving either one. Yeah, you are.
Right.
Yeah, you are. And not making a decision to serve God, he emphasized that to them. Serve the Lord, exclamation point, in verse 14. Serve the Lord. Serve the Lord. That's what we've got to do. Because as Brother Jack said, consequences result from our actions. Consequences result from the choices that we make, whether good or whether bad. But we have the choice given to us. Just before he started out in chapter 23, verse 16, this is what Joshua said. Listen, when you have transgressed the covenant of the Lord your God, he's prophesying here because that's what they did. When you have transgressed the covenant of the Lord your God, which he commanded you, and you have gone and served other gods, and you have bowed down to them, then the anger of the Lord will burn against you, and you shall perish quickly from the good land which he has given you. Let me read that again. Then the anger of the Lord will burn against you. Let me give you a shocking statement. Yes, God does love unconditionally, but God will not tolerate sin.
Amen.
He will punish it. The just will be in heaven, and those who are in hell are justified being there by the warning that God has given us. Amen. Nobody goes to hell without being warned. Nobody just ends up there. The thief on the cross that showed up in heaven, he didn't know how he got there. He knew that by believing in Christ, he was there that day. All I know is the man on the middle cross said, I could be here. That's what the man on the middle cross said. Jesus said, this day you'll be with me in paradise.
Amen.
But nobody will be in hell saying, I did not know. I did not know. Because God will make sure that that happens. He'll make sure that that happens. Be careful about the choices that you make. Be careful. It's not by works that we're saved. It's not by words. But this society is going to be harder and harder to negotiate for Christians as we go toward the end. So know this day. Know this day who you're going to serve. Make sure you know that you're going to serve Christ. Make sure that he's in your heart. Make sure, the old saying goes, come hell or high water, it's going to be the Holy Spirit that's going to bring you through. Make sure that you know that. Stand with me, please. We want to pray for Linda Yost. That's Don Scott's mother-in-law. His wife Marcia's mother. We want to pray for Linda Yost today and keep her in our prayers. I'm going to ask y'all that will, if you will come up, let's just have a good old-fashioned prayer and close out here. Any and all that want to come, let's come and pray. And, well, everything's good in my life, and I really don't need to. Well, then come and pray for me. Come and pray for my life. Everything's good in my life, too, but I always need prayer. Foster's going to pray for his brother Papa. I know that's why you come up here for. His brother Papa has got some heart problems. Got to replace the valve. They can't do the operation. That way you'll have it if he comes home.
Lord, how we thank you.
We thank you.
Pray you have a great day in the Lord.